We will call this meeting to order. This is the March 21st meeting of the Yellow Springs Village Council. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes. Wintrow.
Here.
Houch.
Here.
Sims.
Here.
McQueen.
Yes.
Hemflin.
Yes.
Also present are Chief of Police Dave Hale, Village Manager Patty Bates, and Treasurer Rachel McKinley. Out this evening is Melissa Van Zandt.
And council and staff of the village would like to extend our deep sympathies to Melissa, who unfortunately lost her father over the weekend. So she's obviously with family and taking care of those arrangements, and so please keep her in your thoughts. Announcements.
I had a few.
Okay.
I just wanted to mention that I thought Peace Week was a great success at Mills Lawn School, and wonderful that we could recognize that as council. And I also wanted to thank Patty and several of our officers for being there to support the event. It was really nice, and it also sort of invoked that spring that we're now in. So I wanted to say happy spring to everyone. And finally, I wanted to mention the Why So Serious event that's happening on April 2nd. That's going to be at Memorial Hall, and featuring the Ruby Girls. It's going to be a great event, and I know we all want to support our radio station. So,
Brian Regan.
Oh, yeah, and thanks. We also got this on our table, and these are going to be hanging out in the village. Patty has arranged for the mobile mammography and bone density screening to come to the village on May 27th. And Patty, maybe you can say a little bit more about that.
Yes, this is it's a mobile mammography van, and they will come here. They'll be on our parking lot, and you can make an appointment to have your mammogram done here. They take your insurance, and you call and make an appointment and give them your information. It's covered by your insurance under your wellness care. And if you do not have insurance, they do have funds available through the Susan G. Komen Foundation to pay for your mammogram. So if you do not have insurance, please still contact them and let them know that, and they will get you grant funds so that you can still have your mammogram. And we will be advertising this, and we'll have more information as the date gets closer.
Will that be on the website too, Patty?
We were discussing that today. It's not really a village-sponsored event. It's kind of my personal thing. So.
But I'm sure Susan can put it on. I think it seems Susan, like Channel 5.
Yeah, Susan and I have talked about Channel 5, and she'll be putting it on there for us.
And I see that our solicitor just came in, and the father of the state all-round gymnastics champion.
There she
yes,
is.
Yes, here we are. Is that, are we doing it correctly?
Thank you. Just salute. Thank you so much. It's very kind of you.
Did you know, is this her?
Yes.
The one in the middle.
Great.
The top,
congratulations.
The top Diaz.
Yes. Yes, I had a little experience with that with my niece, so I know how exciting it can be. Anything else or as far as announcements? Okay. We have a larger consent agenda than usual. We have the minutes of March 7th, which has already been noted that the dates on the date on the minutes is incorrect. That's easily corrected. We have Resolution 2016-16 approving check signers for the Village of Yellow Springs. Resolution 2016-18 awarding electric pole placement contract to High Tech Electric. Resolution 2016-20 approving 3 ground leases with Flatter Hereford Farms, and the financials for February of 2016. Can I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Actually, can we pull out the leases and talk about that for a minute?
Sure.
Okay.
We will. So then it's everything that's on there, the 4 items that are on there, excluding the Flatter ground leases.
Okay, and I'll second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay. So do we want to just put that under public hearings and legislation? That makes sense to me. if we pulled it out, why not put it under public hearings of legislation?
Okay.
It will be just, it won't be too much longer. Review of the agenda, so we just added that resolution, 2016-20. Anything else we want to change on the agenda? Okay. Brian, do you want to review the items that were in the packet?
Yeah, so we had three communications. First of all was a letter from the Department of Commerce, letting the village know that alcoholic beverage permits need to be renewed on June 1st, 2016. And if there's any reason we would want to object to one of these licenses, we could do so. The Tecumseh Land Trust has a request to sponsor their harvest auction, and they'd like a decision by May 1st. And Michael Blevins provided a letter in support of municipal broadband, specifically talking about the benefits to business retention, growth, and attracting new businesses.
Okay. So we'll move on to public hearings and legislation. We have second reading and public hearing of ordinance 2016-02. You can just read it in by title only.
Yes,
Judy?
This is to approve the assignment of the Village of Yellow Springs interest in the Fremont Power Sales Contract with American Municipal Power Incorporated to the City of Coldwater, Michigan, and taking other actions in connection therewith.
Can I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Patty?
Fremont is our natural gas, part of our portfolio that we decided last year to divest ourselves from. We have to sell it to another AMP community. This ordinance approves the assignment of our shares of that power generation to Coldwater, Michigan, and along with it goes any debts or responsibilities and payments of debts in the future.
Okay. Any comments or questions from council?
Patty, maybe it would be good, again, just to highlight why we wanted to change our portfolio.
Part of the reason that we wanted to divest of the Fremont is that it's part of it is natural gas, but it also has some coal-fired generators that kick in during peaking. That was the reason that we wanted to divest of that part. In addition, we wanted to purchase more wind and solar, and we also wanted to make room to add our own solar array, which we're doing here shortly.
Okay. This is a second reading, and we will have a public hearing. I'll open the public hearing. Seeing and hearing no comments, I'll bring it back to council table. Judy, would you please call the vote?
Yes. McQueen?
Yes.
Hempling?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
Hausch?
Yes.
Wintrow?
Yes. Let's read the next one in by the next resolution, 2016-17. You can read by title only because there will be a lot of discussion, I assume.
This is resolution 2016-17 authorizing the village manager to sign a letter of intent with Atlas Energy and Power International Corporation to negotiate a contract to build a solar array, and that is on the glass farm.
Okay, can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, so we've got the agreement. We talked about this at the last meeting, and the Energy Board had come to us with kind of narrowed down to two recommended or preferred contractors. With a little bit of prodding, we did get a recommendation from Rick Walkie for Atlas, in that they are this over the life of the contract, it will save villagers around $150,000. Or is it?
I thought it was $175,000, okay. But it's a substantial amount of
so
money.
I will just turn it over to you, Patty, since you've been working on this.
This is a letter of intent to negotiate in good faith. Once we sign this, what will happen is Atlas will come out, they'll survey the land. We walked it with them, Johnny and I walked it with them last Wednesday. They'll come out, do an actual survey, mark out where they're going to lay out the solar array. Then we'll negotiate the additional pieces of the contract, such as who's going to run the power line to it and who's going to do all the other prep work, that kind of thing. It's a 90-day letter of intent, which means we have the obligation to negotiate in good faith with them for 90 days. At the end of that 90 days, if we cannot reach an agreement, we can either extend this or we can go to our second provider.
Okay. Any comments or questions, counsel?
Well, maybe, as I had mentioned in the last council meeting, I attended all of the meetings that the Energy Board was considering this, as well as getting the proposals from the various companies. And the Energy Board felt that this was the best deal, basically because it was the best price, and it was a constant price. Mm-hmm. It wasn't going to be changing mm-hmm. as time went on.
Patty, could you review a little bit of the timeline? So we've got the 90 days. Will they go before Planning Commission within that 90-day period?
They will, and as soon as we get into the contract negotiations and they have the layout surveyed, Denise is prepared to start the conditional use hearing with the Planning Commission to move that forward.
Okay.
So we're hoping that the 90 days can coincide with the approval of the conditional use permit for them to take it to the county.
And then let's just say that somehow negotiations failed with this particular contractor, that conditional use permit, if received, I would assume would be for the project, not just for that company.
Well, it would be to that company, but it would be the same premise, and I'm sure that okay. the Planning Commission, although they would have to have another public hearing,
they would have to have another hearing.
They
okay.
would probably approve it the same way.
Okay. So. Probably go a little faster. Any other comments or questions? Comments or questions from citizens? Seeing and hearing none, I'll bring it back to council table. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed.
Okay. I would like to read the next resolution, 2016-19, in full. I think when we do an annexation, even if it's for the Glen, it's something people need to understand and have questions about.
Sure. This is a resolution to authorize the village manager to serve as the petitioner's agent for the annexation of 422.106 acres of Glen Helen. Whereas the Antioch College Corporation petitioner would like to annex 422.106 acres of land in the township into the village of Yellow Springs, the village, and whereas the village and the petitioner agree that the annexation of the area known as Glen Helen will preserve and protect this valuable natural resource, and whereas it is required an individual serve as an agent for the petitioner for the annexation, and whereas Patty Bates has agreed to serve as the petitioner's agent to assist in this annexation, now therefore the Council of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio hereby resolves that. Section 1, the Village of Yellow Springs Council hereby accepts and authorizes Patty Bates, village manager, to serve as the agent for the petitioner for the annexation and to take all steps required to pursue the annexation. Section 2, it is hereby found and determined that all formal actions of this council concerning and relating to the adoption of this resolution were adopted in open meeting of this council, and that any and all deliberations of this council and any of its committees that resulted in such formal action were in meetings open to the public in compliance with all legal requirements, including but not limited to Section 121.22 of the Ohio Revised Code. Section 3, this resolution shall become effective immediately upon its passage.
Thank you. Can I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
So this is actually, there's been quite a delay between when this first came to us, was first brought to us by Nick Budis of Glen Helen, and this, just lawyers getting, and I think surveys and things getting together. So this is basically asking, I think the reason the Glen wants to do this is so that they know that the Yellow Springs Police Department is covering and providing services to the Glen. Some of the delays that were happening, there was some concern about delays that were happening with the sheriff's office. And although Sheriff Gene Fisher actually did want to express that he felt that they were responding as quickly as they could. So, you know, this isn't casting any aspersions on the Greene County Sheriff's Office.
And I think that a part of it as well was to alleviate the confusion as to who actually had jurisdiction, because when you're in the Glen, you don't necessarily know that you're in the PD's area or in the Sheriff's Department area, because you're in the middle of the Glen.
Right. And it's actually kind of nice to know that the Glen is part of Yellow Springs. So, I mean, I think we feel the Yellow Spring is there, so I think we feel that it is anyway. So, any comments or questions from council?
Patty, do you want to highlight the utilities issue as well, since that came up?
Yes. There was a concern from some council members as to whether we would have to provide any additional utility services, and this was something I did specifically talk to Nick about, and he says that all of the facilities that are currently within the portion that we're annexing already have our services, and that there will be no need to extend services to anything else, part because we're not annexing the part south of Grinnell.
Okay. And I think maybe to clarify also that with the police services, Chief Hale has indicated that he doesn't see this as an extreme burden, that there actually is, our officers are responding in a lot of situations, but unfortunately they have no authority. So part of this is to give them the authority. So any comments or questions from citizens? Seeing and hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed.
Okay, and then resolution 2016-20 about the flatter. I don't think we need to read that. Patty will just explain it.
Okay, this is authorizing the village manager to renew farm leases with Flatter Hereford Farms Incorporated.
Okay. Well,
a motion and a second.
Oh, motion, yes.
So moved.
Second.
Okay.
We have three leases with Flatter Hereford Farms, and Sharon Flatter is here tonight, so I'm sure that she can answer any questions that I can't answer. There are a couple of changes. There were some typos in the leases, and we also struck one provision on the glass farm lease under the property section number 3, which says leasee agrees to cooperate with leaser to negotiate application of treated sewer sludge from lessor's wastewater treatment plant to the subject property at times and in a manner acceptable to both parties. Sludge will not be applied when crops are growing on the property. That has been struck. We do not apply sludge to the glass farm or to any other of our areas. We dispose of our sludge in a different manner. So that has been struck out of there. There was a typo in, I believe it was the hayfield lease. It had a dollar amount typo where it had a couple of extra zeros on the end. And we did add one disclaimer where if their crops are damaged by us in any way, shape, or form, we will pay them for the damage. I don't believe that's going to happen, but they did ask for it. Chris and I talked about it, and it did seem logical to give that to them.
Right, considering they're very likely maybe construction going on at the glass farm at the same time that they're trying to farm. It clearly they'll be sharing an access road, and I think everybody will try to cooperate, but things do happen.
Right, and I also know that there has been a question. I had a question posed to me last summer, and I did talk to Sharon and Jerry about it when we discussed renewing the leases, and that has to do with the sustainable practices and using fewer pesticides or green pesticides and herbicides. And from what I understand from Sharon and Jerry, they use a minimal amount right now. You apply dry pesticides and herbicides, and you do that once every 2 years or once every year?
Fertilizer would be once a year, pesticide would be once a year as well.
Okay, and we did discuss this leases, these sets of leases are only for 2 years, and we did discuss that in the next 5-year renewal that they will look for greener practices and to use less pesticides or greener, you know, more natural organic pesticides.
Okay. comments?
Well, we didn't get the leases in our packet, or I didn't anyway.
You got them in the online packet, only they were quite extensive.
Yeah, okay, I didn't realize that.
Yeah, there really aren't any changes to the conditions.
So the one question I had was the length of time.
2 years.
And you just answered that.
Yeah, we're trying to get them to all expire at the same time, because they were all three expiring at different times.
That was my main concern, both because of the potential sale of the Sutton Farm as well as construction on the glass farm.
Right, and what we did is, I had talked to Nick about if we were to sell that property under a Clean Ohio grant, how long could the lease be for? And he said 2 years, and that's why these are all for 2 years. And we also took out of production the back section of the glass farm, although I do expect that they will farm part of it, because we won't be taking up all of it, even at the busiest part of the construction. But that was, 10 acres of that was taken out to allow for the construction of the array.
Okay, those were my questions.
Brian, did you have any questions?
Well, yeah, I just wanted, I mean, the issue about the pesticides, can we maybe talk a little bit more about what minimal application means, or?
That'd be maybe a much broader scale than we can discuss today.
Uh-huh.
You know, based on quantity and the type, I wouldn't have all that detail with me at this point.
Okay. And have you guys had a chance to look at more green options yet, or?
Not at this point in time.
Okay. Okay.
Any other comments or questions? Okay, I'll take the vote. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Okay. Now is the time in the agenda where we hear from citizens about items that are not on the agenda. Is there anyone here that wants to speak to something that's not on the agenda? Okay. Now we'll go into special reports. I see a lot of people here to talk about special reports. So the first report we have is mediation annual report to council, and I see Mr. Gudgel here.
Good evening. Good evening.
Good evening.
Hi. Hey, John.
So hopefully in your packet, I know this morning I brought a copy of the annual village mediation program of Yellow Springs report from 2015. John Gudgel, village mediator coordinator. I guess one of the segues I'd like to make about mediation is the fact that I received an email from a parent last week who said to me, in my other job as guidance counselor at Mills on Elementary, they said they had a situation involving their fifth grade son, and that their fifth grade son said to them, can we mediate this conflict that we're having? And the parent was amazed that child had said to her, let's go into mediation. And so the mother said that we actually mediated and resolved the situation. So I felt pretty good that what we're doing at the elementary school is actually starting to have and make inroads among our young people. However, with our adult population, that's another topic. In 2015, there were 10 actual mediations that came to fruition. I received 30 referrals, so you're probably asking, well, what happened to the other 20? Somewhere between when a referral comes to me and before it actually goes to mediation, sometimes the disputants decide that they don't want to go through mediation. Often they work things out. In order for mediation to take place, both parties have to agree to mediation. We are not a binding organization where we can force both parties into mediation unless there's a referral that comes from the police, mayor's court. I'm dealing with one right now where there's a dispute between two parties that are supervised by a third party, and the third party said, you must do mediation or we're going to remove some particulars as it pertains to your agreement. So again, 30 referrals, 10 mediations, 20 somewhere down the pipeline between the time they contact me and before it actually goes to mediation, it's settled in one way or another. So the goals and objectives that we had in 2015, a number of our mediators have been around since the inception of the mediation program that Mary Ann McQueen was a part of back in the late 1980s. A number of those mediators have been around for the period of almost going on 25, 30 years. And they said to me, John, we're willing to help out, because all our mediators and volunteers were willing to help out. But if you can find some new mediators, that would be greatly appreciated. So one of the goals in 2015 was to increase the number of new mediators, which we did. In fact, we increased from 5 mediators that were serving when I got on board 6 years ago. We increased that by 6, so we have 11 total active mediators. And these individuals, many of them are new to the community, but were seeking out how they could help the community, and we were able to recruit them. Some of them have been mediators in other positions. In fact, one of our current mediators served as a mediator with the Dayton Mediation Program. So what do the mediators do besides mediation? Well, some of you who I've worked with, the mediators facilitate Human Relations Commission of Yellow Springs workshops. They've been part of the Village of YS Fiber discussion. I know Brian has contacted me and said, hey, John, I need some mediators to help facilitate. They were part of the ACE Drug Task Force Police Forum. I've also used mediators in some of the positions that I've been involved with, such as the 365 Project, working in the village, or excuse me, working with the school system. I've used them. Networking with the local schools was also a big objective for me. It's interesting because I wear many different hats, and sometimes in a moment's notice I can turn from school guidance counselor to village mediation person. In fact, there's now blurred lines. Parents will come to me in their capacity as parents saying, hey, we need a mediation. So quickly I go from guidance counselor to a mediator for the village. So there's some blurring of lines. But some of the things that we did with the local schools, Janet Mueller, who works at the Dayton Mediation Center, did a conflict resolution workshop at Mills Line. We've worked with students promoting inclusion, diversity, and equity at in education at the high school. They're called Spidey. We've provided facilitation to a number of government and civic groups. Some of the other highlights are highlights that we had during 2015. Chief Hale came to our boys' night and talked to our young men. We've used mediators at Girls' Night. Peace Project was recently completed at Mills Line, had aspects of mediation. Restorative justice dialogue with Yellow Springs High School administrators and mediation training and workshop at Mills Line. Sidelights, got an opportunity to meet with the international fellows that visited last year from Malaysia and the Philippines. Yes, I'm not even going to try and say their names. Distribution of the VMP information cards to Yellow Springs Police Department. In fact, I have a couple of those with me today. Mediation workshop with the Human Relations Commission. A new initiative I'm working on is working with the National Alliance on Mental Illness, NAMI, which has become real active and engaged in the village. Ongoing discussions with Patty Bates and the Village Council Mediation Steering Committee, which initially was Jerry Sims and now is Mary Ann McQueen. Last November 15th in 2015, Patty and Chief Hale came to our mediation meeting, and I thought that was a very productive session. Thoughts for 2015-2016, making a greater public awareness of the village mediation program. You know, that's always going to be at the forefront, because people will say, well, we don't know that there's a village mediation program in Yellow Springs, and that's one of those things that we have to do a better job in terms of increasing our awareness. We had a couple articles in the newspaper over the past year or two. We've placed cards at the Chamber of Commerce. We've placed them downstairs, placed them at the library. So just getting the word out that we're here and available, and it's a free service. It's a free service. Working with the village on examining aspects of restorative justice and mediation practices with the Mayor's Court and with the Yellow Springs Police Department. Continuing the networking curriculum of conflict resolution skills and mediation within local schools. That's a biggie for me, and I think we've done a full court press at Mills Line, but now we need to try and implement it at the high school, McKinney School, and providing professional development, ongoing training for mediators. The practice of mediation, right now we use a philosophy called transformative mediation skills. It's a no-win situation. You try to reach a compromise. It's real big on listening to what the other person has, reflecting their thoughts, and trying to redirect to try and get away from the emotional aspect of conflicts. I know it's a quick presentation, so I'm here to answer any questions that you may have. Thoughts, concerns?
John, oh, yes. Go ahead, Judith.
What's the training for the mediators?
So the training, good question. What does the training involve? So 2 years ago, and I think, Jerry, you were there, we brought in some specialists from the Dayton Mediation Center, and it was a two-weekend workshop of about 8 hours. And what it involved was, again, the transformative philosophy of mediation, the no-win. So what does involve? A lot of role-playing, particularly in terms of understanding when two disputants have a disagreement, trying to eliminate the emotion that's behind it, trying to provide a safe environment, a trusting environment. Sometimes when people want to come to mediation, they sometimes think, is there going to be a public record? And I say, no, the only record of it is in a box in my basement. So the training basically involves, Judith, trying to provide mediators with strategies in terms of recognizing the empathy that needs to go with people, because often they just want to listen to one another. And there's a lot of similarities with disputes with adults and with kids. Kids, they want somebody to listen to them, to listen to their side. And the majority of the time, because there is no win situation, the training just involves people understanding the art of compromise and agreeing to disagree.
John, your first part about the fact that you have 20 that, you know, hopefully did get resolved actually, but I'm struck by the number of people who hear the word mediation and immediately recoil. I mean, and to me, it sounds pretty easy, you know, given the alternatives.
Right.
Are there any other words? I mean, is there another that people that we could, and maybe there's especially since it's not legally binding.
Right.
I mean,
right.
Or is there something that could be presented to people as a conversation alternative that isn't called mediation?
You know, that's a great question, and I may have to deflect that question to Mary Ann when they came up with the mediation program. You know, you use the word mediation, and it can be, there's a lack of understanding. For some people, there's a fear of intimidation. They see the word mediation. You know, that's a great question, because even at school, when we have conflicts with kids, we say to parents, are you comfortable with Mr. Gudgel or Mr. House doing a mediation session? And immediately say, yeah, we're okay with it. So, you know, I wish I had an answer for you, and I don't want to dodge the question, but I really, you know, once I explain it, people are comfortable with it. You know, when we pick up the Yellow Springs News and we see that Yellow Springs police officers mediated a situation, to me, the word mediation, because I'm involved in the field, is a very non-threatening term. When I explain to disputants what the mediation entails, for citizens, I think the biggest fear is they feel as though it's kind of a public venue. When I say a public venue, that this thing would be put in the newspaper.
Because so it's a village count. It's under village count.
Yeah, so I don't know. I have to think on that one. I wish I had an easy one-word answer, but I don't.
John, maybe one of the ways that you can not only advertise or get the word out about mediation, but also explain that it's not a public thing and it's not going to be published, is maybe you could get with Susan and do an interview for Channel 5.
Sure, yeah.
That explains what the mediation program is and the fact that it isn't public and it is a private type of process and what it entails. Maybe that would be a good way to solve
sure,
both of those
issues. I'd be glad to do that. I know Diane did a nice article 2 years ago with Lauren Heaton. One of the things that I'm fighting is that our society is turning into a society that they go for the jugular and they want the win.
Really? That's such a surprise with what's going on right now.
Yeah, I mean, that's, you know, so it's hard to get people to, but putting the word out, but yeah, it's just, you know, I'm in it to win it.
Yeah, the adults aren't helping, are they?
No.
The adults and the supposed leaders are not helping much.
Yeah.
So, John, without, you know, violating any privacy, could you give us some idea of the nature of, you know, some of those 10 cases, just so we can kind of understand what, you know, the positive benefits
to
the village?
Sure, I would say probably two or three of them involve tenants and landlords. Boundary lines between neighbors also seems to be a biggie. I would also say that noise, you know, violation of a noise ordinance or a so-called let me back away, misinterpretation of the noise ordinance. Lately, the last three that I've had actually originated with kids that somehow transferred to the adults, which is really weird from the standpoint of, as administrators, you know, we can deal with the kids stuff, but parents, they become advocates for their kids and they see no wrong in their kids. So where I talked about the blurred lines, the origins of the problem might have started at school, but then the parents get involved and are going at each other, so then it leads to mediation, because as school personnel, technically we don't really have any authority over parents. We don't have any 30-year-old fifth graders in our school, so it becomes difficult. I don't even make light of it, but landlord disputes, boundary disputes, situations between kids where the families get into it, those seem to be the big ones. I'm trying to think what else has come down the pipeline. And then referrals from the police or mayor's court, and those, there's no certain specific ones. I mean, they're all individual in nature.
Right. No, that's helpful. Thank you. Yeah, because, you know, one of the things, you know, we think about with this program is how it avoids either costly litigation or, you know, sort of continued negativity. So glad to hear that.
Right. And not, it saves, it can save time for our police officers. Mm-hmm. It can save time for our zoning inspector who, you know, can refer something instead of being in the middle of something. Mm-hmm. So,
How do you know how do you judge the effectiveness of a particular mediation?
So we do an evaluation. So when the disputants finish with the session, you know, we do an evaluation. At our last meeting a couple weeks ago, it was mentioned, Mary Ann and several others mentioned that, John, why don't you start doing a phone call like a week or two as a follow-up just to see where people are. Because people with evaluations, they tend to try and get them done in 2 or 3 minutes. So they check all the boxes, you know, like, dislike, and you get very little reliable feedback. So that's a practice I need to begin. So a week or two, just call and say, hey, what did you think of the mediation? How are you feeling about how the situation resolved itself or not? So that's one thing I have to do. Brian, getting back to your question, other types of disputes. We've had a couple of that have involved some of the store owners here in town, whether it's they want somebody not to come back into their store, but they want to talk it out as to why they don't want the individual to come into the store. So there's been a couple involved local businesses.
Okay. Great.
Rachel, did you have a question?
Well, I was just going to make a comment that if you want to get the word out, because we're talking about white stuff, put something on that,
Thanks.
And maybe some of the radio stations that other mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, thanks very much, John, and
thanks to
your mediators. Please pass along our appreciation to everybody involved with the program.
Thanks a lot.
No problem.
Next, I see the CAP annual report to council. Are we reading that, or are you presenting? Oh, excuse me. I didn't realize there was a CAP member here. Okay.
Actually, the whole CAP is here.
Okay.
the remnant. So I'm Jordan Gray, one of the villagers.
And Tim Barhorst.
We are in hiatus. we did lose two members in the last month or so. So in lieu of the annual report, we couldn't finalize that and officially send it to you and so forth. So we're going to report just on some basic kind of updates from us, and we're just coming to you as concerned citizens about CAP, since we're not official. But just kind of a recap on two different transitions that happened and are happening. This last year, with Susan Gartner doing the station manager role and coming in with a target of 20 hours, she's mostly floating around 30 to 40 hours still. But that fluctuates, and she has been able to hit a few 20-hour weeks, which is great. But predominantly when she explains what that 20 hours typically takes normally to just handle the village processes and the announcements and so forth, that's the lion's share of it. And then to kind of get to the community, the rest of the community activity, and integrate that, she goes into these additional hours. So trying to have the whole complete package, she's trying to still compress that. And we've got some ideas about how to help her with that. Another key transition to mention, and I'm going to come back to the issue of how we might be able to help Susan a little bit more with just workflow and so forth to make things a little bit easier so the burden of work is not too high. The other big transition in 2016, Time Warner Cable has been moving to full digital over the past 2 years, but they've dropped the final letter and said, April, full digital, we're switched over. So there are some implications in terms of the technology going forward. Right now, we can still broadcast at the lower definition, and that's all fine. But at some point, that affects the consumption and the enjoyability of the Channel 5 presentation. So moving into the high def, which is actually still older technology compared to what's come up with ultra high def and so forth coming down the pike, we think it's a great opportunity to jump into that. There are a lot of the funds that come in from the franchise fees could be leveraged. We don't use too much of that in most cases, except more recently with getting the station manager. But we might be able to help the transition fully into digital by appropriating some of those funds to getting the equipment we need to kind of start this next chapter. Just kind of going back a step, so those two major transitions, getting into the station manager role and then switching into digital. So there's a lot of things happening. Discussing internally with CAB, we were talking about the workflow of getting stuff from the community. And it becomes a little bit tricky to get files dropped off, thumb drives. Sorry, I didn't bring a drink. Thumb drives and so forth. So it's extra work for Susan to have to process that data, convert it to the right size and so forth to get it ready for a presentation. And one of the things I had offered actually myself is a little pro bono system. We manage digital media for like 15 years, and we will offer if the village still wants to move ahead with it. We had decided it, never acted on it, and now we're dissipated. But if we still wanted to do that, that's still available. There's no cost to the village. It's a bridge, a digital bridge between Susan and the villagers. And what that would do is someone sending in a 5 megabyte file or a 3 megabyte photo or a bunch of photos, it automatically flattens them, knocks them down to the right size that she's going to use. And we can have it knocked down to both the current version and also the next version. So she has this library of files starting to build up so she can quickly assemble these programs. And every time you save that little step, it's just another small amount of minutes away from her, again, her overage on her hours during the week. And we can do the same thing with video. So if villagers submit video, we can also knock that back and make that more compressed and just sufficient enough for the presentment. The other thing to mention is the village doesn't need to become a repository of storage for community members to store their files. So we're not looking for them to send us original files, and then there's no promise that CAP would retain a village chapter. I'm sorry, chapter, Channel 5. Sorry, thank you. No, that's fine. I'm almost good. Thank you. So there's no promise to them that we will retain their original. So they know right away when they move files into the system without disrupting her, they can send them in the system on their own. We can solicit photos to be contributed into programming that she defines. I think I might want to drink actually. I can see why some people reach for the glass. That's better. That's the main point. You guys get the point of that. There is one other thing, and it might be information in the packet. I don't know, Brian, if you include the Vibe bit, anything about that or not.
Didn't have a brochure, but if you want to mention it.
During the year, we had looked into a service that's based off of Latronix, which is Vibit, which is their live streaming, which we get a lot of requests, I'm hearing, from villagers for live broadcasting of these events. So they can consume that on the web like they're already on. So So we want to meet people where they're at. Not everybody's sitting in front of the cable as much, or they'd rather be in front of the computer. And so we have these multiple channels that we can distribute this video or this media to. And there are some costs with that. And again, some of the extra money that we haven't been using could be set up and used while we still have it towards trying that out or getting it going, seeing if it's viable. And there would be some new equipment needed to get the live streaming the right encoding, so these machines are kicking out the right stuff for the live feeds. We're hoping, there's also one other thing that we just mentioned is the social media policy that came across your tables. Is something that we had kind of thought through and put out there. And if you remember, towards the end of it, we were very much pro in that policy that broadcasting outbound over different social media channels would probably be the first thing if you wanted to open up a new channel of social media and involve the village with it. First, just publishing outbound is the safest start, you know, first step. And again, when you start producing this kind of a content, the visual, the live feeds and so forth, you know, using some of those channels, again, you just meet different populations that are kind of hovering around their favorite social media. And that's it for right now. If there's questions.
I have a question about whether you really have to disband. Chris, you need to be paying attention. How many members do you have? Three.
Three. So there's a quorum, but we don't have, I thought there was a five-person council.
Yeah, that's what we're understanding.
Is there anything that can be done about that until they, as long as they're actively searching for new members?
Well, there's three members of a five-person. They've got a quorum, I would think.
But isn't a quorum based on a total number
of
members?
Yeah.
Right? I mean, so
actively seeking people in their recruiting, I mean, I don't think that it prevents them from performing their function.
What were you saying, Brian?
They'd have to be unanimous.
I mean,
the quorum is calculated.
Yeah, quorum is based on, you know, a number
of
members.
I know, but if council members are missing, we still have a meeting, as long as we would have three.
Right, but that's, missing is different from not having members. So
well,
two people have resigned.
But votes are taken. I mean, votes are taken with three people. We've done that, you know, not very often, but we've had that. We've done that. So I would, I'm not sure that I think you have to disband. I would think you would be actively seeking membership, and Judy can do that.
Well, we've been missing members from commissions at different points
right.
in time.
But we've had those members. I think what's different.
No, we haven't.
No, I think what's different here is that we actually, I think we have people that are interested in seeing it go forward. In other commissions, when we didn't have enough members, there was literally no interest. There was nobody there at all. Here we've got, it appears that we have three interested members.
We're still very interested.
Yeah, I mean, to me, that's what makes a difference.
We don't feel bad. We can still do a lot of work without being official. But we were thinking of parlaying that into, hey, we need more CAT members. We're down to three,
right.
And try to do some more. A newspaper, you know, and also mentioned the high def and the streaming and some of the direction that we're headed.
There's some great things. I mean, you guys are doing great things that will help Susan, that will help the community. So I just hate to see that languish.
You could also, if it's an ordinance created committee, you could amend the ordinance to make it a three-member committee.
I mean, I think that's what, I mean, the ordinance does say 5 to 7 members. So, but amending it.
Oh, it's 5 to 7.
And I think we did take out the non-residency portion of it, or did we leave that in?
I think all of the commissions are allowed to look outside right. the village boundaries for members.
Well, but do we want to reduce the number if we want? Because probably you could use more help, right? If you
definitely need more help.
So we don't want to reduce the number. We want to just give you time to.
Right. I still wish we could be more fluid on those numbers. I mean, I know we reduced it to 5. I think they all say 5 to 7, except Planning Commission.
Well, I know that, for instance, one of the letters that was in council packets tonight from Mr. Blevins, I know that he is new to the area, and this is an interest of his. Perhaps he would like to serve on CAP.
Yeah.
If someone wanted to contact him.
We could do that.
You know.
Yeah, we think we'll turn this into a bigger push to get more members, because there is a lot of exciting stuff, and it's kind of a pivotal community collaboration moment where we might be able to get some energy. And
right, I think
we think there's a lot of ways we can still make Channel 5 very relevant and expand the operation in the near future.
And I think the one caveat that I would have is that Chris made a very good point that it would have to be a unanimous decision to move forward with things.
How often do you vote? I mean, there are...
Just once a month.
Oh, so you do vote, what, just on minutes and things? Okay.
Yeah, we haven't voted on last month's minutes.
I mean, if nothing else, can you all be considered volunteers? I mean, to the station and do the work you're doing?
Well, that's what, when they originally came up, they talked about, you know, sort of this concerned citizens, you know, supporters of CAP. But I think the other message that we're hearing is we'd like more members to come forward. Because there is a lot to do.
Yeah, I mean, it seems to me that there should be a period of time. If, I mean, we can't just disband every commission if they lose a couple of members.
Right.
So it seems to me that there's got to be some sort of a period of time of new membership coming in to get back up to that five.
Well, why don't we just verbally agree, say, let's give you guys 3 months or
right.
some time, get a couple more members, and if you don't get a couple more members, come back and we'll figure out some other way to make you legit.
Sounds good.
The only, you know, we're saying you guys, when we should be out there.
Yeah, we need a little
right.
help. You know,
right. Oh.
We, you know, and soliciting our members. You know, we as council, we put this thing together. You guys volunteered. We had other folks that, for some reason or another, decided to get off. But I think we now need to make a real big push to get members, and we probably need to put a little bit better explanation in the media. What
maybe a letter to the letter to the editor,
yeah, I mean,
sort of,
you know,
describing.
Yeah, maybe Brian, you could write that. I think talking about the exciting things you're doing. I think sometimes,
right.
you know, nothing against Judy, but when you just put the ad
right.
in the paper asking for members, it's not always that exciting. But we could write a letter to the editor about what a great group you all are. So
that's good. Is there any problem with us pursuing the, since we are not, I guess, are we continuing that as CAP?
I think so, yeah. I mean, we're all in agreement.
That's great. The next step that we would probably pursue is getting the digital bridge for Susan to the public, where they can load files and she can receive them pre-made, you know, pre-sized. So I can get with Patty.
I mean, that's a staff coordination thing.
And we're going to do some additional research on what the live streaming options would be. There's a couple manufacturers that have various programs that we can look into.
Yeah.
Because we think the live streaming is a very important thing.
We've been talking about that for a long time. I mean, and if there are budget implications with that, maybe it would need to come back to council, but chances are it's still going to be under Patty's limit.
The annual fee to have live streaming and on demand that works with our Latronic software is $6,000.
Oh, that's not bad.
And it's something that, I mean, it would also improve workflow, because it automatically processes. So basically, when Susan flips on that switch, everything would happen.
That's great. Yeah. Well, I mean, I think you're hearing very positive support from council to continue with the work you're doing.
So is someone going to write a letter?
Yeah, I think Brian. It's his commission, so it makes sense.
Yeah, well, we'll collaborate. Okay. So, but I think that's a great idea.
Thank you.
And just to put it out there, in case there's any kind of issue with the meeting, if we just go ahead and we'll publicly notice everything when you meet, continue to take minutes as an unofficial group, that way there can be no question about it being an open meeting of any sort.
Next is our treasurer's report. Rachel McKinley, our village treasurer, is here. Lots of numbers, and they never look any better, unfortunately.
they look a little better.
Yeah.
Well, there, it's not exciting, really. the balance did go down a couple hundred thousand, it looks like, and not even, not quite, 140.
140.
And we continue to use the Star Plus as the best deal that we can get without incurring any risk, which I don't think there's anybody wanting to incur risk on the investment side. If and until I hear that you're willing to, then, you know, we'll continue to use the Star Plus investments. And right, as of in 2015, that was a 0.2% yield, which is, or I'm sorry, annual yield, the average slightly more than 0.2 to point, and then now in 2016, we're up to 0.3.
Wow.
Wow. Anyway, you know, it's just been such, ever since I started, I feel like I'm, you know, the curse on interest rates, because this is not the only treasurer position I hold, and it's the interest rate environment has just been low ever since I started. With that, you know, we try to get the best we can. The Star Plus is, you know, as good a thing as, and the nice thing about it is that it's all insured, you know, so there's no risk whatsoever. You're never gonna lose money. And again, we continue, because of low interest environment, we continue to utilize the earnings credit on our checking accounts, because that's better. That reduces our fees. Our fees are large enough that there's plenty of them to reduce, and that nets us at a 0.5% on those. If we were to get interest-bearing checking accounts, we would earn essentially nothing on those accounts. So we continue to use the earnings credit non-interest-bearing accounts at U.S. Bank. I don't know. I think that the numbers here kind of speak for themselves. There's just not a whole lot to report. Obviously, Melissa does all the heavy lifting when it comes to working your numbers, but, you know, I just kind of take a look at the investments, and the overall cash flow seems adequate. You know, that's one thing that I can say, is that I feel like we've always kept adequate reserves, and the fact that we've got, you know, nearly $7 million in that reserve is a good thing.
So, Rachel, just to clarify, the decrease of $140,000 and some change was due to
money getting transferred out for
transferring
operations. Yeah.
Okay. And can you say a little bit about your initial comment about risk? Like, what are we talking about? Like, what are potential other options?
Well, you could go into some different investments through banks. There's, God, I'm gonna have a senior moment. Basically, paper, there's a word for
bonds?
It. Pardon?
Bonds.
No, you could invest in bonds. And I do go to the continuing education so that I have the capacity to do that under the Ohio code, but
More like a stock portfolio type of.
Yeah, you could do something like that, but there's also just short-term lending to banks, basically.
Certificates of deposit and things.
Yeah, like, and the thing is, there just aren't enough. there's not a big difference in what you can get that's still risk-free. Mm-hmm. Once you get into securities, then you're going to assume risk. And my understanding was that, you know, that the village, at least the input that I've received, is that they just don't want to incur that risk.
I would clarify by saying, I don't think we want to incur risk, but if, as our treasurer, if you see something that looks interesting, mm-hmm. and that you feel would benefit us, we would like you to bring that to us.
Okay. Yeah.
I'm not going to sit here and say, oh, we don't care about the risk, but we, if there's something out there,
right.
as markets change.
That's what I wanted to say. Yeah. I mean, that's what a lot of the other municipalities get involved in is commercial paper. And that is basically through private banks.
Can we invest in municipal bonds? I mean, those are the kinds of things. Wouldn't it be cool if we could invest in the development of infrastructure?
Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't know. I mean, that would be
for us or for other people. Communities.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. One of the big things about investing in municipal bonds is there's a tax incentive to do so, because you don't pay taxes on those. Well, we don't pay taxes on, so that
mm-hmm. you lose that incentive
as an individual. There's that incentive. Oh, if I invest in these, then I don't pay taxes on the gains or whatever. Mm-hmm. But as a municipality, that's a disincentive. We've investigated, you know, we have gone down this path before in looking at different investment options, and I'm more than willing to do that. But like I say, when I've put in some time trying to research that, I've never really gotten much positive feedback. And so the best thing I can do is try to go through the state, which is guaranteed, it's, you know, it's safe, blah, blah, mm-hmm. blah. Lots of other municipalities, that's what they do.
Right.
However, that being said, could we increase it? Maybe. Will we pay more fees? Absolutely. So there's a balancing act.
Okay.
One of the things that I think about, too, is if, you know, any future projects, if you need to go out and get bonds, you know, if you can somehow tap into this reserve rather than borrowing. But I do know that the state auditors and all that stuff, when they come in, they want to see a certain amount of reserves. They don't want to see you down right. to zero. So with it, and there are limitations in that regard, because if you're investing in something risky, then that's going to make you look less solid. So it's a balancing act.
Okay.
But absolutely, you know, we can talk about that, and Patty and I can get together or with Melissa and revisit that, because I know we went down that road probably about 3 years ago or so. I think before you came on board, actually.
Yeah, I think it was right before Melissa came on board, actually.
Yes.
She's been here a little bit longer than I have.
Yeah, but. Yeah. And so, yeah, I'm absolutely okay. willing to go down that route.
Yeah, I personally am interested, and I think it, we should at least research what the options are,
mm-hmm.
know what they are.
Yeah.
And then, you know, that cost benefit.
Right, right, and do that analysis, yeah.
And the only other thing, and this is probably more directed towards Melissa, although you may be able to answer it, Patty, I mean, I'm glad to see that we're down to basically only coming out of pocket around $3,600 for service charges, bank service charges. Are we doing everything we can to just automate as much as possible and to continue to reduce those fees, Patty?
Yes, that's one of the reasons that Melissa is trying to move towards that automation.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely, and that's a huge improvement over years ago when I came on board. Our fees were ridiculous, and so we have cut into that. But in this low interest environment, we're getting killed on
right.
on making money on the money sitting there, you know, and it kind of pains me a little bit. You know, I'd like to see it make more money, but again, you've got that risk reward ratio you've got to work with.
Jerry, do you have anything to say beyond what's been said?
No, it's to me, it's all about risk. You know, how much risk are we willing to take?
And of course, if you diversify, you reduce that risk. Right. And that's one of the things that the Star Plus kind of does for you. They diversify. I mean, if you go look at where that money is invested, it's in, you know, 100 different banks. Our money is invested with 100 different banks. And they do all of that, making sure that you don't exceed those FDIC limits so that if one bank defaults on something or whatever, you are insured. So it's a good product, it really is. That being said, could we do a little better if we went out there and tried to get it on our own? I don't know, maybe. It's worth a look, I suppose. So, any other questions?
Okay.
Okay, thanks.
Cool, thanks.
Thanks.
Next, moving on to old business, we have a financial report and discussion about a proposal from Glen Helen to purchase a portion of the Sutton Farm. Patty?
As council knows, Nick Budis approached us last meeting with a request to purchase a section of Sutton Farm, about 73 acres?
Just under 76 acres.
What council did ask for a couple of different items. From me, they asked for a financial analysis of what we make on the leases compared to the taxes that we pay because we make money on the leases. And that is included in your packet. Although I did have a little trouble tracking down the dollar amount on the taxes because the auditor was actually only charging us about half. And so when I emailed them and said, why the heck can't I find the bill? He goes, oh, because we're only charging you half of what we should. We didn't realize you were leasing out so much. So that's, you'll see in my financial analysis there that while we were charged on only 23.479 acres, they will be adjusting that and charging us on the whole acreage that we are going to be leasing to the Flatters for the next 2 years. So we make on the leases $3,681.25 for the leases on that part of Sutton Farm. This is not on the entire acreage of Sutton, but on those parcels. And we pay approximately, or will pay approximately, $2,506.68 in taxes once it is adjusted. So that would be the financial analysis where we make about $1,100 a year profit off of the leases. I think Nick's memo that he has included in here explains the history of why they would like to acquire this part of the Glen, and he is here to right, speak to that if council would like him to.
Yeah, Nick. It was a good report.
Thank you. I appreciated your request to put those thoughts in a memo form, and I would be happy to speak to any questions that anybody has about that document.
When you spoke to us last time, you were talking about a grant.
Yes.
But it would not be a 100% grant, that you would also be looking for the village to forgive that remaining.
That's correct. We would hope to reach agreement that the sales price would be 3/4 of appraised value, essentially.
And I will say that we have attempted to contact 3 appraisers. You have to have them off of a specific list of approved appraisers for this grant. And we've tried to contact 3 of them, and none of them have returned our calls yet.
Mm-hmm.
So
you suggest in here $150,000. Is that what you're guessing from experience?
For purposes of putting a safe number out there without pinning ourselves down, I think it's reasonable that the number would be north of that, but I It's I'm engaging in severe speculation if I put out a number before an appraiser has a chance to look at it.
And that's the three quarters.
Yes. Yeah.
So that the 150 is the three quarters number.
Or, that's right. Okay, that's okay. Right.
But for the grant, I heard Patty say you try to contact three different
appraisers.
The grant, does that specify that it has to be appraised by
someone off of this list?
Off of, mm-hmm. it, off
yes.
of that list. Mm-hmm. Now, given that, and I think there's a timeline.
Mm-hmm.
What was it, May 1st?
Sure.
I know there was a timeline for getting
the firm deadline is July 1st for okay. the application. What I'd put forward to council was having some sort of option agreement in place by the beginning of May so that we've got time to prepare a proposal. And if there's some issue in terms of getting an appraisal done by the beginning of May, then maybe we try and pursue an option agreement that builds in some additional time to complete that appraisal between the beginning of May and the grant application deadline at July 1st.
Okay, but if I'm understanding you correctly, the grant can't go forward without the appraisal.
That's correct. Okay. The appraised value is, okay. is a core part of the building the budget for the grant.
Now, this question is to you, Patty. Have you ran into this situation in prior that, firms, appraisal firms not wanting to?
I don't think it's that they don't want to. I think it's just that they're all really very busy right now. Mm-hmm. I mean, because there is this extra grant cycle
okay.
that Nick is talking about applying for. And I think that all of the appraisers on this list are just
tied up with
crazy
the,
busy right mm-hmm. now. Mm-hmm. And so we will just continue to work our way down the list and try to get a hold of one of them.
Okay.
I just want to say that I feel at this point I can say that I support going forward with this with the request by the Glen Helen
Association.
And it looks like it's financially good for the village. It's environmentally great for one of the great assets of the village, the Glen. And I love farming. I grew up on a farm. It's great. A lot of farmland around here, but that particular piece has another particular value that I think is at this point more important than the farming that's happening there in the long term. So,
okay. So Patty, what do you see? You're working. How long does it typically take to get an appraisal?
A couple of weeks, up to a month if they're really backed up.
Wow. So, I mean, we could be cutting it close, but
right.
I guess what I would suggest, at least what I think we're hearing from council, is that we're supportive of this moving forward, just keep going
it.
As it is.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess the other thing that I don't know that we need to talk about it tonight, but for council members to think about potential use of those funds.
I'm not sure that we're all...
Yeah.
Yeah, I think we should probably
okay.
vote.
I think we should have
okay.
Yeah, see, my concern is, with the land that the village owns in general, and we really don't have a plan as to the use, disposal of our land. Mm-hmm. To me, we've had two cases now, one being... the solar array that we pulled out a piece of the land that we own, and now we have a second one coming toward us, and we don't, and if I remember correctly, we also had one where the garden,
But that's a commercial piece of property.
But it's still land that the village owns, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And we are entrusted as council to manage the land mm-hmm. of the village. And in order to do that, that says you should have some plan in place. Okay, so we're not caught by surprise, you know, when someone makes a presentation to us. In other words, if we had a plan that says, you know, we have green space out here, it's for the benefit of the village, our philosophy and so forth, this is how we're going to dispose of it or look at it, commercial property and so forth. But we're at least from my standpoint, I'm always caught by surprise or off guard by a proposal to dispose of our land, and we got a narrow timetable to look at it. And that's always been my concern.
I would typically agree with you, Jerry. I think that Nick does do a pretty good job of laying out the fact that this is really not commercially viable land. It's already under a protective easement that will never allow it to be developed beyond farming, and that the reason that the village purchased it in the first place was to maintain it as green space. And I think that the farming became an outgrowth of that. You know, we've got this land, it may have been being farmed at the time. So, I don't see this as an appreciable, you know, we're talking about it's either going to be farmed or it's going to sit fallow. And if it's going to sit fallow, I would certainly rather it be being stewarded by the Glen and helping the Glen meet their goals.
Go ahead.
Well,
sorry.
I think what you were saying, Jerry, is that you think that we should have a plan, sort of a master plan, I'll say, for how we deal with land that the village owns, as opposed to taking an opportunity that comes up when it happens to come up.
That's the way real estate works, though. You know, opportunities arise that you can't plan on. I mean, I would have thought this would have actually been a great opportunity that we might have said, hey, you know, I would have never thought that the Glen would be coming to us for this. I wouldn't have thought of us going to them. You know what I mean? I just think for this piece of property, it's about as good a deal as
I mean, if there was some reason that we wanted more farming that we wanted to have on village-owned land, I mean, if there was some reason for that, there could be. But given the limitations on the use of the land by the conservation easement that already sits there, I mean, theoretically, we could use that $150,000 and buy some other land if we felt like we needed it for some, you know, in terms of what are we going to use that money for. It would be three quarters of the amount. We could buy some other farmland or whatever. But to me, this just seems like a very excellent opportunity, and we should take it. I think it's hard to figure out what that master plan of all these pieces of land, I mean, how to think about that. We always have trouble thinking about land, that kind, you know, what to do with village land anyway as a community. I think it's always been somewhat difficult discussion. And so having a master plan seems like that might be a hard master plan to come up with.
And I think when there is a commercial value to a piece of property, that it is much more incumbent upon us to do a pretty extensive analysis of what our options are. This property really doesn't, it only has agricultural value, or it has conservation value.
Well, I will say I agree with Jerry's point that we should have a master plan. I also agree that it's not easy to do, but you know, I would like us to continue to work towards that in general. I'm not sure it affects my decision here, but I agree that that's important.
I appreciate Jerry's concern and think that it's really, I guess, beyond our capacity right now. I mean, not only do we not have a master plan, we really don't have a plan for managing the land that we own. I mean, it was great that we got the grant for getting the invasives out of the along the creek there, but we own it's not taking the invasives out all of our property, I don't think. And I mean, there's other property that we own, like Ellis Pond, that
Like the parking lot next door, like the parking lot next door.
Various things that we're not managing to the ideal standard, but I mean, at the same time, like, you know, we have a small staff and we're a small village and we have limited resources. So I do appreciate Jerry's point and would like to see that as a goal that we aim toward. At the same time, I do think that this proposal meets the purpose that this property was intended when the village purchased it as green space. So I support this.
So, I mean, does somebody want to make a motion that we, basically at this point, we're just instructing staff to move forward with getting an appraisal. That's the next step, and that we're in general support of that movement until we get final details of the appraisal.
Yeah, before we make that motion, I just want to clarify two things on the report. I think maybe some of us are aware of this, but I haven't heard it emphasized, but why we're talking about 3/4 of the appraised value, which is the required 25% match.
That are the resource. That's essentially the resources that we would be able to bring to the table. There's no additional cash that we can bring from anywhere else to do it.
But there has to be a 25% match to get the Clean Ohio Fund grant.
The match is the donated value.
Right. Yeah. And then I also just wanted to point out, again, it doesn't affect my decision, but the idea that we can invest this on a 5% return, we just learned that would not be possible.
I needed some tool for evaluating an annual fee versus a pot of money. And when I think of return on investments for a nonprofit, I think about a reasonable internal
amount. And it wasn't, I didn't bring it up so much as a challenge, but just I wanted that to be clear that the village can't do that, but we can do other things with those funds.
And it sounds like, given the tax burden being higher than we thought, that the difference between the value to the village on a sale versus the value in an ongoing basis is even more extreme than I had thought.
So do we have a motion to direct Patty to move forward with getting the appraisal?
I'll make that motion.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Thanks, Nick. And anybody else from the Glen that's here? Thank you. Next is on to new business. Judith and Marianne presented a report on their proposal for moving forward with the Village Justice System Task Force. So I'll turn it over to them to explain and talk about next steps.
Okay. Should I just go ahead and read this out?
However you guys want to present.
Okay. Why don't I go ahead and do that? It's just a page. So just the next step in this goal. So the Yellow Springs Village Council has committed to a new goal that involves review of an update of the Village Justice System. The Village Justice System includes the Yellow Springs Police Department and the Mayor's Court. I have spoken to Mayor Fobert and Chief Ale about Council's wish to strengthen these important local institutions. Below are our initial thoughts on the purpose, charge, and structure of the task force to assist Council in pursuing this goal. The Village Justice System Task Force will be a working group that researches and develops recommendations to strengthen the Yellow Springs Police Department and the Mayor's Court. It will also seek ways to increase the public understanding of the police department policy and practice and strengthen public trust in our village justice system across race, age, and income groups. The initial work of the task force will be to inform itself and the community about how the Mayor's Court and the Yellow Springs Police Department currently function. Once it has oriented itself to current practices and policies in the YSPD and the Mayor's Court, the task force will seek opportunities to enhance both institutions through research into best practices, innovative approaches, and reforms impacting justice system issues. Task force research will include but not be limited to, first, clarifying what cases go to the mayor's court. Secondly, the possibilities regarding pre-prosecution mediation and restorative justice practices that could strengthen the role of the mayor's court. The role benefits and drawbacks of including a prosecutor. new developments in municipal policing practices that address institutional racism and alternative municipal policing approaches to drug control. Resources for the task force will include Mayor Fobert, Chief Hale, the United States Department of Justice, Human Relations Commission, the Village Mediation Program, NAMI, TCN, the Village Solicitor, Chris Connard, Village Manager, Patty Bates, the Village Council, and other municipal, regional, and national organizations engaged in justice pursuits. The task force will consist of, we couldn't quite figure this out, so we put 9 to 11 people. Sounds kind of big, but there might be a lot of work. One member could be from the township. It will include a liaison from Village Council, HRC, and Village Mediation Program. Additional members will be citizens with an interest in the goal, and especially members of the community with experience. Also, involvement in relevant issues, such as activists from Black Lives Matter movement. We encourage young people from Antioch College and Yellow Springs High School to also apply. Interested citizens are encouraged to apply for membership to the task force, and Village Council will appoint its members. The task force will meet monthly in open meetings as per the Sunshine Law. So, in some sense, it's a restating of the goal with just a little more thought about, you know, the number of people. We mentioned particularly young people and, you know, activists in the Black Lives Matter movement who I think often have particular, sometimes difficulties with their relationship with the police department. So having them involved in these, you know, actively involved in this task force, we thought would be a good thing. I don't know if there's any questions.
I just had a couple. And when we talked about the task force, including, I would prefer that we say mayor, chief of police, and village manager. And the only reason I say that, I'm kind of assuming that this is going to be an ongoing task force. And as people come and go, would that require council to rename, you know, if the chief
left or the mayor? Oh, you don't want their names. Okay,
but, I got
you
what you're saying. Sure.
Just make it generic.
Yeah,
just make
right. Generic. So that says if you want to be mayor of Yellow Springs, you're going to be on this task force, or chief of police.
Right, yeah.
You know, we're not negotiating those things. You follow me?
Right.
And I have kind of mixed emotions you know, we named the Black Lives Matter movement. Are we kind of saying movements of that nature we would encourage to be part of the task force? Or, you know, because let's say Black Lives Matter dissolves, but there's another group that has the same goals in mind. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't know what the right term to use, but...
Well, we dealt with this when we passed the policy, the vision for the police force, because that came up that time, too, and Lori generalized that language.
Okay, so as long
as we have it.
Yeah, okay.
Because I remember how she generalized it.
Yeah, I think it was just, you know, like groups that, you know, are advocating for rights or something like that. So it was a more, but we have
it
in that vision.
You know, if that particular group starts to go in a direction that we're not comfortable with, I would still like to have an organization with that philosophy as part of the task force. With the philosophy if you follow what I'm saying.
And I think that it was something to do with diversity, potentially, because it could be multiple kinds of diversity.
Yeah, I'd like to see that, you know, when we finally agree upon that particular term.
I think this was really good. The only thing in the paragraph after the bullet point, I still have this thing, and I was doing this on the goal statement, that I feel like we need to separate out, when we talk about resources, our own internal resources, to me, are different than the Justice Department.
I feel like we need to
separate that. I mean, we can direct staff to do things that we can't direct the Justice Department to do.
Yeah,
and
I guess.
And we can ask them to do. So, I mean, I see our staff, our solicitor, as being more than resources. I mean, I think we're partners, or, you know, there's a different way to look at it. I don't know, maybe, or at least just to separate them out in the line, and just like Jerry said, to take out the names and.
Okay.
Other comments?
And I know you, it's a nitpick, but you said number one, two, and three, but I see the task encompasses all of them, and we feel that all four bullets plus any others that come up, we're going to look into. And but I do have one question for Patty and the chief. You know, in terms of, you know, our role as council and the role of the task force, you know, council basically hires the manager and the clerk, and then the manager then hires the chief and so forth. Do you see any conflict here with the task force and your role as supervising the police?
No, actually, Judith and Marianne and the chief and I sat down and we talked about this, and chief and I had a couple of concerns, which we voiced to Judith and Marianne, and they said, oh no, that's not, that, you know, we're comfortable with this concept of how this is going to work. We think this is a good way for this to work, where, you know, with the research and the input and all of that coming to council, and then council making the decisions on the policy. And so, you know, we sat down and talked with them, and we're both comfortable with this kind of format.
Hate to put you in the spot.
I think
the public needs to hear that, yes, you're committed to this.
No, thank you for asking, because, you know, we obviously had heard a couple of things, and we just wanted to be sure, and so we did sit down and talk, and we're perfectly fine with this format.
I think our solicitor would like to speak.
Obviously, a number of conversations that we've had collectively, and I don't think it's inherently a bad idea. In fact, I encourage it to get outside sources because they have different perspectives. But it strikes me that the starting place with this really needs to come within. Ultimately, this is a village matter, and sometimes when you get a lot of outside entities, you lose sight of what we're here for, which is the village. And having been, when I was deputy director for public defender, the public defender's office in Montgomery County, I became involved in discussions like this. And I would suggest to the council that that we discuss this internally to identify what it is we really want to talk about, because there's lots of concepts, lots of ideas, lots of things that you can lose your way in the discussion. And I think that kind of happened in the context of the task force discussion. There were many broad ideas that I think that most people would agree with, the war on drugs, you know, things that have been societal issues for a long time. But what we're talking about here is the village. And I'm not sure that my participation, for example, on a committee like this, and I think it would be an exciting thing to do, but I think that I'm still not clear how council feels about that, and how the chief and Patty, just from a community standpoint, and the community being defined as the boundaries of the village. And I think that in part we were going to discuss some of that at the retreat a little bit, but it seems to me the starting place really ought to be narrow, and then we can figure out how to use the bigger pieces. That's just my suggestion, having been on some committees like this before, that we really need to start small.
I wasn't actually seeing you as a member, or the resources, the resource people. What I was imagining, and I think Mary Ann was, but I'll let you speak for yourself, though, is that the committee, you know, it will be citizens with these liaisons as part of the group. What I'm imagining is the first discussions are the chief coming and the mayor coming and talking about what the committee's going to have questions, you know, just to hear about how things are going right now, how things work, you know, and both the mayor's court, so that we get a better sense of, you know, currently what's happening, so we get kind of that foundation. A couple of people that I talked to about this too already, like this idea of pre-prosecution mediation, I guess is happening in some of the area communities. And so, you know, with the notion of restorative justice, sort of the notion of trying to find solutions to problems without it necessarily becoming criminalized, you know, some behavior, some action. So that would be researched. And then when I put the Department of Justice in, really, there's been this national discussion, and I think that's what I'm thinking we're referencing when we talk about, you know, there's been this national discussion that we look at what people are thinking about to try to address some of the concerns, and that we learn from that. So that was. And I'm not sure exactly where you fit, except that it seemed like there would be a place for you somewhere in this discussion,
And I will participate in any way that you ask me to.
I was imagining. I don't know.
But my sense is that from the discussions, and since I was part of that process for so long, and an advocate on behalf of the voiceless for so long, it's a complicated discussion.
Yeah.
And I still, I just seems to me that before reaching out, that there needs to be a perspective of what the village hopes to accomplish and what realistically can accomplish, because some of the things are beyond the village's control because of how the system is set up.
Right.
So let me see if I understand what you're saying, because when I'm listening to you, I'm thinking that maybe you're suggesting that council agree on a list of questions, concerns, whatever. Things like, we know people continue to say, we don't know the police officers. You know, if they lived locally, we'd know them. Well, they don't live locally. But an issue is that it seems like a perception in the community that people don't know the police officers. So that's a simple and complicated, but that could be maybe an example. Council would like this group to continue to find ways to integrate police with the community so that the community knows the police and feels comfortable with the police. Is that the kind of thing you're saying, that we have like a list of maybe a dozen things that we're looking at that we direct this task force to investigate?
Well, I think that's part of it, but I'm not sure that some of it requires a task force, again, in that broad sense. What I'm saying is, having watched this, having been on both sides, and I'm not necessarily saying this is your solicitor, I'm saying this is just somebody who's been involved in this discussion for a long, long time, is that, we have the justice system as it functions has a local piece that can be defined by at a municipal level. Then we've got a county piece, and that's governed by the state, and we've got a federal piece. We have all of these pieces, and there are limits to what the village can do within the context of that. Certainly this village has taken some strong and clear and bold steps when it comes to its position on fracking and the idea of welcoming immigrants. And we knew that when the fracking legislation was passed, that was a symbolic statement, because the State House had said that we cannot govern fracking locally. So to me, the discussion in part has to be, okay, what do you as a body want to accomplish for the village itself? And some of it can be accomplished, what may be considered to be the low-hanging fruit of let's get to know our officers better. Some of it, when you get into these broad discussions about restorative justice, what the village wants to, may want to accomplish in that discussion may not be entirely possible because of the other pieces of the justice system. And I'm not sure that putting the task force together at that point to have this discussion, it would be a useful exercise of time or until there's a better understanding of that at the council level. That's all I'm saying. And I gather that because, I say this because, in my experience, people have who have never been involved in the criminal justice system, they look at it from the outside in, don't necessarily understand how it works. We perceive how it works, but there's how it works and how it really works, and then what one can do with it. And I'm not saying it's a broad discussion. I'm not saying that this shouldn't move forward in some way. It just
could
seems...
Do you think that the committee itself could start those conversations?
I think maybe.
I mean, maybe that's the way to do it.
That's what I'm thinking.
Is to actually have the committee to have a conversation with the council. And
I mean, I was going to ask you what your next step was. I would assume your next step is to write a charge, and that you do you have a time frame on when you want to try to get this task force seated?
Well, as soon as we feel like we're clear, and so maybe that is the thing to do, is to actually integrate into it the first discussions with council itself, and so we can get some input from citizens. But understanding, what is the local, what authority actually can our local system do? I mean, the mayor's court, that's very obvious. There's only certain things that can come to the mayor's court. There's certain things I'm sure the police department are, told how they have to deal with that sort of incident. I don't know.
From my standpoint, I mean, this is very important to me, but for it to be, for all of this to be a big council discussion, I thought that's why we were, you two had really taken this on, and why we were talking about a task force, so that we could put it with a group whose passion this was, and that could then bring back reports and information to us, so it didn't become, the whole discussion wasn't all with council.
Yeah.
Very similar to what happened with the task force discussion. I would be ready. I mean, as far as I'm concerned, I would be ready for you and Mary Ann to come back with a charge, with a very specific charge of what this task force will do, time frames, whatever else, however else we've always laid out those charges for either permanent or temporary task forces.
Okay.
Brian's would.
Well, just one thing that this discussion makes me think about is how we ensure some diversity in this group. Because I think when I look at, some of the folks that would potentially be involved, there may be a similar way of thinking about the issue. So I just want to kind of throw that out there that, we want to have sort of some healthy discussion here. Mm-hmm. So.
Yep. Okay, well, why don't we work on it a little bit more? Feels
okay.
Like. What do you think?
Yep. Is that good? Thanks, Chris.
Yeah, and thanks for the input.
So something that I should have said at the very beginning of the meeting, and I apologize for, is to thank the citizens of Yellow Springs profusely for so generously and strongly supporting our levy. It passed by nearly 80%, and that is very heartening for us to feel as if you're trusting our work and the decisions we're making, and certainly trusting the work and the competence of staff. So thank you. Moving on to manager report, we did have Melissa's in the packet.
Yes. The installation of the new electric meters is about 95% complete, so we're still on target to be done by the end of the month. We did sign the phase 3 streetscape contract last week. He should be starting by April 13th, if not a few days earlier, and as soon as Jason gets a firm date on that, he will be letting everybody know. We do plan on doing that with the specific staggered schedule that Jason had developed last year, where each business will hopefully only be disrupted for a week to 10 days while we pull it out, pour that section, and then move on to the next. Brad's report is in there as the water and wastewater superintendent. We also signed the contract with Shook Construction with the and issued the notice to proceed with the design portion of that contract. We actually have two announcements for the police department. Chief Hale has just returned from his week-long class in Louisville on management of small law enforcement agencies, and you see there that there were quite a number of different states in attendance there, different nations. Vermont, Alaska, the Navajo Nation, and the Virgin Islands were there, with had chiefs there as well. And also today we had a new officer start, replacing Officer Spurlock, and that is Officer Whittemore. The planning and zoning ordinance that is in there from the last time, and we're still going to gather information from the Planning Commission. That's kind of a placeholder for me so that I don't forget to continue doing that. And the last thing, I actually have two things. One thing that is not on my report is there is a tree in the island out here. If y'all know where the picnic table is, where the island makes the bend, there is one large tree out there that is dead and needs to come down. So when that tree comes down, I don't want anybody to be surprised. It's the only one we're talking about taking down, but it is in bad shape. And so that tree is going to be coming down. And then the last thing that I have is that there has been some discussion amongst the staff about possibly charging for special events, with staff's primary concern being the impact on the departmental budgets. There is also the opinion that these can be considered economic development activities and investments by the village. And so before staff goes any further with gathering any information on this, we'd like to know if council wants to consider charging for those special events and the costs that we put into them, or if that is not something that council wants to consider because you feel it is an economic development activity.
What are you talking about?
We are talking about everything from street fair to zombie walk to all of the different events that we have.
So the idea, so say it again, what you the idea is to charge a little fees to defray costs.
Yes. And there is also the opinion that these things can be considered economic development activities.
How difficult would it be to give some examples of how much time, expense the village puts into some of these regular events?
Well, I have some basic numbers, and most of them range anywhere from $800 for zombie walk to upwards of $9,000 for each street fair. We have any number of smaller events. There's Zombie Walk, YS Pride Day, Tour de Coupes, the Bike Road Race, Cyclops, the Mills Lawn 5K, the Simply Women 5K, the 4th of July, Village Fam, St. Paul's Party, Street Fair. And these are all not necessarily, these are not village-sponsored events.
How would it be done?
That remains to be seen if it's something that council wanted
to look at.
Yeah. And I bring this up not only because staff has brought it up, but I've had residents also ask me if this is something we're considering.
I think it is worth considering.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree. I've been approached by residents also complaining about or questioning who is paying for our services, or are we providing these services free, and is there a priority that we give on what services we provide to what groups and so forth. So I think it's something we need to look at and see, you know, if we feel it's a economic development benefit or whatever, if anything is free or if not. But I think it's a discussion we should have. Excuse me.
Brian, did you have
Well, I just wondered, is there a way to also get data on the benefits generated? I mean, so I see where it's, you know, easier for us to think about what the cost would be.
Right, I think that maybe if, maybe the businesses could provide us with that, maybe we could ask the chamber to provide us with street fair and zombie walk, which are our two biggest events, you know, that the vendors or the merchants downtown see revenue from. So we can certainly see if we can get that from them. And we have been doing a little research on whether other communities do or don't do it. Some of them do, some of them don't. It's just, it widely varies.
I guess I would, you know, without doing too much work, it would be nice to know what other communities do. Mm-hmm. And it would be nice to reach out to, you know, those business owners, mm-hmm. and, you know, just to get as much insight as we can.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So. Like I said, before staff spent a huge amount of time on it, because what we're talking about here right now is strictly man hours. It's not mm-hmm. anything else we put into it.
Okay. So,
okay. And then I can go on to Melissa's report. If anyone has any questions about her report, we are moving forward on the
Safer. Oh, I'm sorry. There was just one thing on the grass mowing deal. So I guess I just wanted to, last time we had mentioned that Environmental Commission was also going to weigh in on this, mm-hmm. But it does seem to me like we should be responding to it sooner rather than later.
I'm planning on talking about it during the report, Environmental
okay.
Commission report.
Okay, cool.
The Safe Routes to School project, which I know has been on everybody's plate for quite some time, is moving forward. Melissa and I met and have chosen the two required consulting firms from the list of approved consulting firms that ODOT has. One firm will be doing the appraisals of the right-of-way acquisitions, and the other firm will be doing the negotiations and the actual title work on them. They have to be two separate firms. Really, that's the big news. The remote meter project I've already talked about, and apparently we've had some folks wanting to use American Express cards, and we currently cannot accept American Express cards because of their security protocols. We do accept MasterCard, Visa, and Discover.
Just going back to Safe Routes to School, we were talking about this years ago. I'm just wondering, we were trying to get some funding. I'm wondering where that all is.
It's with MVRPC, and it's sitting in a pot.
Yeah. Oh, it's still there. It's sitting there waiting.
Yeah, it's okay. It's actually,
I didn't know. I thought we had lost it.
No, we've got it.
I actually browbeat them into giving us a little bit more. So,
for you.
So we're actually, ODOT funds will be paying for from just west of Fair Acres, and it will go east down Fairfield Yellow Springs to Pleasant Street, and then down Pleasant Street to where the current sidewalk exists to make a connection.
You mean Winter?
Down Winter to Pleasant.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. And then we, as the village, will actually add the small part from where the crosswalk is down to Stafford to complete that part. But we don't have any match on the ODOT project now.
And I did send you some information. I think, didn't I send you information about crosswalks? I've heard a lot and
right.
seen a lot of things on the Continental crosswalks that stripe all the way across to make them more visible, and I would certainly like staff to be looking at those mm-hmm. for Safe Routes to School and for downtown.
Right, and
if everybody doesn't know, 68 downtown is going to be repaved this summer.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And Jason actually did meet also with Chris Bongiorno mm-hmm. about the crosswalks on Dayton Street, and so maybe there's an opportunity to start there with those, because a lot of the kids from Fair Acres come out there.
And we did have a recommendation for rainbow striped crosswalks.
Nice.
You know, talking about crosswalks, and you know, I try to drive through town at different times during the day and the evening, and you know, we're getting more and more tourist traffic and really what's, you know, I only go about 15 miles an hour through town because you never know when someone just walks right out and either in front and back of a car and crosses where they want. Spring is coming, summer is coming. I just want to stress with us right. locals, you know, you got to have a swivel head. You know.
But I will also bet that those people that are walking out in the middle of the street without using crosswalks and without watching the traffic are locals
yep.
because yeah. every place else I go and I'm walking, cars do not stop.
No,
so Yellow Springs expects, pedestrians expect that, yeah. the cars are going to stop. Nobody else expects the cars yeah. are going to stop.
And it's,
just before we leave Safe Routes to School, I think it's important to have a few things out there to think about for the future. One of them is, Judith, I've learned that a lot of communities have Safe Route to School administrators that get these projects moving, you know, more quickly. And both Melissa and I are going to the National Safe Routes to School conference. It's in Columbus the week after next. But there, you can't apply for money to pay someone to do that. And this is the only program that does not require a match under, you know, the different funding that we can get from ODOT. But I think we also need to be thinking about moving forward with our discussion about sidewalks, what the next Safe Routes to School project is. Mm-hmm. I realize this one's taken a while, but with the knowledge that we'll get, this could be a way to do some of the things that we want to do very effectively. Mm-hmm. So.
Well, I'm going to pass some stuff on to you because I see another area that we really need to look at. Okay.
Judy?
I have nothing of great importance other than happy spring and very grateful to have had the levy pass.
Thank you. And I just want to clarify that I left, I wasn't expecting a discussion on the event situation, so I left. I'm sorry I didn't officially recuse myself, but that's why I left. Okay. And I will be recusing myself from any further discussion. Let's see. Oh, board and commission reports. Jerry.
Okay. Planning commission, two areas that we're looking at. One we just completed, and that should be coming to council, and that's, I think it has to come to council. That's the language on the swimming pool mm-hmm. spa area. The second area that we just started tackling are signs. And which will come to council. So that's kind of what, you know, but planning is kind of taking a look at where we see inconsistencies or maybe vagueness in terms of what's in the zoning requirements and what is actually happening and whether it's been grandfathered or not. So we got a nice young group.
It's been a good discussion.
That are, they're energetic, so we're mm-hmm. going to take advantage of them while we can.
Yeah.
That's all I have.
Anything on Finance Committee?
No. I think the biggest accomplishment has been that monthly report that, mm-hmm. that you folks mm-hmm. get and with the graphs up periodically and so forth. So I you know, I'm at a point where, you know, I'm confident that Melissa understood what we needed, and I think she's providing it. And I'll just wait to hear from you folks if you want something tweaked.
Okay, good. Green County Regional Planning, there was an executive committee meeting last week. There's a board meeting this week. We're considering two apartment. I'm not actually sure if they're apartment. I think that there are rentals in Sugar Creek Township. Previous to that, we the request for Spring Valley for there to be a gravel pit put on the aquifer. The Spring Valley aquifer was unanimously defeated, but now it still has to go through all the local planning groups. So hopefully I think that they'll see that that's not good. I mean, I will just tell you that the amount of acres planned for development in Greene County is absolutely astounding over the next few years, absolutely astounding. So that whole section of 35 to the south of 35, all along by the airport, that whole area, 600 and some acres to be developed, lots of housing going in Sugar Creek Township, Beaver Creek Township. Ed Amrine is very busy. He's Beaver Creek Township zoning administrator, and he is probably the busiest zoning administrator in the area right now. So it's, you know, nothing we can influence. I'm there. You know, everybody's following the rules. I'm glad that there is talk about regional collaboration on bike trails, on open space. They are really talking about connecting developments with trails, with and they're collaborating with the Parks Department. So from that standpoint, it's good. It's a lot of development. So
is there an expected increase in population, or is this
Well, probably. I'm guessing an increase in population in Greene County. It could translate into a decrease in population for Montgomery. I don't know. I'm assuming that, you know, every report I see, every study I see from MVRPC says that the population of the region is not going to increase appreciably, but we're still building a lot of units of housing. So it's, people are going from one place to the other.
Okay, me? All right, so community resources is very quick. They have, over the past couple months, been meeting internally, so council liaison has not been invited, so I don't have anything to report there. Yes.
Do we know when, I mean, given that we have a relationship with them, for better or for worse, I guess, and an interest in the property, the CBE is proposed on, do we have a time when they're going to open up things, or, I mean, I think...
They're in communication with staff on some issues right now, so I think that's on in the works. Discussions and opening up the meetings are in the works.
Yes, Denise and I have a meeting on April the 4th with them, so I may or may not have something to report after that, at that meeting. I think council meets that night, actually.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, good question. Economic Sustainability Commission, I just want to mention that the group is continuing to talk about some of those more immediate issues, such as our village incentive policy and the revolving loan fund. And you know, again, still a new commission, so just trying to, you know, get the feel for where everything is going. I wanted to announce that the Arts and Culture Commission did select the Spring Vita winner. So that's the Village Inspiration and Design Award, and that is the Dharma Center. And one of the things that was highlighted is just, you know, how beautiful that space looks. And we will be having a ceremony in April. So the traveling trophy will move to the Dharma Center. And at our next meeting, I'll have the date and time and all that, but it will happen there.
What is the traveling trophy?
So John Hudson designed, it's in the shape of a Y, and it's got actually a little kind of birdish figure on it. And it's engraved with the sponsors and everything. And so this will be the third award. And that was the idea, that it would travel and sort of be outside wherever we're recognizing, and then they get a plaque that they can keep at their business or home.
Cool.
Yeah, very cool. So that means we're looking for applications for the Summer Vita, and we'll be talking about that more as we go. I also wanted to announce that through revising the public art policy, and in particular looking at requirements to get the John Bryan Community Gallery back online, we are ready for applicants. So we have those procedures in place. Melissa felt very good about where that was at, and I think the village staff was involved in making sure we could handle that.
Does that have to be approved by council?
Yes. So the process is the application goes to Patty. It then comes to the commission to make a recommendation, and then it then comes to council. And if, you know, council wants to look at that more in depth, we can. Okay. So then finally, the community access panel. I think it is great that we've kind of said, you know, please move forward with this group of three, which includes me in an unofficial capacity. But I still think it's very clear in the ordinance that without five members as it stands, we cannot make any decisions. And that kind of leads me to, there are two documents in the packet that we don't have to decide about it tonight, but I think they need approval. One of those is the station manager job description. And so I don't know if we want Patty to take over that responsibility or if council's going to do that. And the other is the updated rules for the station. And there aren't a lot of major changes, but one of the changes that I think is important is if community members want to check out equipment to give Susan a 72-hour notice so that she has time, because again, she's not a full-time volunteer or worker. So I don't know what's the best way to handle that, but I feel like procedurally we need to do that correctly, and or, you know, change the ordinance. But I think we need to address that sometime at some point.
Well, I mean, that it seems like that's something that that citizens should be aware of. So maybe it needs to be brought as a resolution or something to a meeting. I think as far as a station manager oversight, I think that should be done by staff. I mean, isn't that the way that's set up anyway? That,
well, historically, you know, the charge for community access panel was to provide that oversight. But I mean, to me, especially now that we've
but that was when it was a volunteer position. It's
right.
Now a paid position.
And I don't know that we ever clarified that. Yeah. So
it was a paid position in the past.
It had oh, that's true. Initially, yeah. It was yeah. done by Patty. That yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So just to say,
what's your preference?
Well, I mean, Susan is here during the day, and sometimes she asks questions. It seems like to me that it would streamline it if she just reported to me, just for expediency's sake on some things.
That would be fine.
Yep. I think that sounds great. And then, so maybe with the rules and procedures, we'll bring that back to the next meeting?
Yeah, I just feel like if it's something that's impacting the citizens, that there's a change in rules, that they should probably at least be aware of it.
Right. And then I do want to thank, we saw Susan's, gosh, it's been almost a year.
Yep.
Wow. Report, which I thought was great, very enlightening. And it ties nicely to the presentation from Tim and Jordan, mm-hmm. just about what the potentials are for the station. Mm-hmm. I think we've agreed for a long time that community access is very important. I certainly want to see, you know, that ability to have enough citizens involved so that we can move forward with that transition. But I didn't know if anyone had any questions for Susan, because she did, you know, cover quite a lot of ground.
Right.
Doing a great job. Thanks.
Okay, that's all I have.
Judith?
Yeah, I don't really have much to report. Energy Board made their recommendation about the solar array, and then last month they took off. And so we didn't have a meeting. Library Commission only meets every other month, so they did not have a meeting. So, and I don't do village mediation.
Yeah. I do the village mediation. Okay. So I met with the village mediation last week, and one of the things we did talk about was the possibility of police citizen mediation, and it's been something that we'll be setting up a meeting with the chief and Patty later to do. That was one of the main things that we talked about at that meeting. And then, of course, we got the report from John. And I will say something. I didn't say while he was here, but he mentioned that there were 30, I think, referrals to him. Mm-hmm. And I guess 10 of those came to mediation. But just having someone call the mediation program frequently helps that person think about what's going on. John, I'm sure, talks with them. And sometimes just resolving it, or at least maybe it encourages the person to talk to the other person. Mm-hmm. That's very helpful. And it doesn't actually have to go to mediation for that service to be useful. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to say that. I haven't met with Steve Kahn with the school board, and I am going to be doing that soon. So, in fact, I think I'm going to start meeting with him quarterly, suggest that we meet quarterly, because I've just sort of not been doing it. The Environmental Commission, I have a pretty big report from the Environmental Commission. First, I'll talk about the mow date thing that was brought up. We did discuss that, and we have not come to a final decision. We will be, I assume, at our next meeting making a recommendation to come back to council. But the discussion centered on a couple things. One was that if people have lawns that have grass, that to be able to maintain the grass effectively, you should be mowing before July 1. What that date, what the outside date would be, the Environmental Commission wasn't prepared to say at the last mm-hmm. meeting. But the other piece of it is that a couple of the members have been working on developing language to put into one of our existing ordinances about lawns that would allow people to naturalize part or all of their lawn within whatever parameters we have established, which would mean having natural prairie plants or a water garden or different ways of having your property besides having it be in grass, and having particular parameters around that. So that's been something that some of the members have been discussing for a while. So we want to combine that both. You know, if you have grass, this is when you should start mowing, and if you want to do other things, these are the parameters around the other things. Mm-hmm. And in fact, there will be a presentation, a workshop sometime, I'm not sure when, spring or summer, that
on the pesticides?
Yes.
That date hasn't been set yet. We're looking at sometime in May, and I really wanted to mention it before Sharon Flatter left, and I completely forgot, but what Marianne is talking about is the Beyond Pesticides grant that we received to train the village crew on the organic pesticide use on village properties and how to do that. And they're also going to do a public meeting section, we hope, in the evening that everyone can attend, where they can talk about organic pesticides and how to properly use them. So, Marianne, do you want to talk about that a little bit?
No, I don't have anything more to say okay. about that at this point. Sorry. But I will say that we have added another section to the projects that we're doing, mm-hmm. which is education and outreach. Right. And George Coder, who we approved as an alternate at our last meeting, maybe, is taking that and running with that. Mm-hmm. And our first activity will be to have a booth at the Glen Helen Earth Day. And each of the projects that we're working on, including the Beyond Pesticides, will have information at that booth.
Right, and the one thing that I thought Nadia had asked you to mention about the Beyond Pesticides grant was that they are going to pay for 100% of coming down here and teaching, doing a survey and then teaching our staff, and that's, the grant covers 100% of that, but would council be willing to put in an additional stipend if it's necessary to have the evening session, just to have them do that one more session and
sure.
potentially stay over another night, just so
I mean,
that we can
have a couple hundred bucks?
Something like that, just so we can have the
It seems reasonable.
The community come in and hear the information.
Where did that grant come from?
It was something that Nadia Malarkey found, and it's a group called Beyond Pesticides. And apparently, they're benefactor-funded and industry-funded, and this is what they do.
Mary Ann, are you, with the education piece, the Resilience Network is doing a lot right now. I know I'm getting lots of emails from Macy Reynolds, who I think is part of that. Are you coordinating with what they're, because it seems like there could be a lot of overlap and either overlap or mutual benefit or collaboration?
We have members, Duard is a primary, well, actually, several of us are in the network. And the network is working with Community Solutions during the 6-month period. The education that I'm talking about in terms of the booth at the Glen Helen are things that the Environmental Commission itself is doing, like the wellhead, the glass farm, Beyond Pesticides, and, well, there are four things spacing out on.
Okay. Well, it sounds like you're doing enough.
Four things.
Climate action.
Yeah, the climate action.
Cool.
Yeah,
okay.
Thank you. Okay. So I want to talk a little bit about the Clean Ohio grant and the work that's being started on the glass farm. If you remember, we got a grant valued at about $80,000, which includes some in-kind things that we're providing in terms of a conservation easement on the glass farm. But this is a 2-year grant, and the first activities that are going to occur will start happening later this month, which will be beginning to remove some of the invasives on the eastern part of the glass farm. So along King Street and then moving inward, removing mostly it's Bradford pears. And we're going to have two signs, one on King Street and one where the glass farm comes up against Thistle Creek, that will be there for the duration of the grant period. And the signs will talk about, you know, the work being done is being sponsored by Tecumseh Land Trust with the village, and we're going to be naturalizing the area. We'll talk about what's happening. We're also going to put a letter, we're in the process of getting a letter together that we will actually, I think, walk around to the neighboring properties along the glass farm to let them know what's happening, because there's going to be a big mower that's going to come out and do some of this invasive removal. So the first step is removing invasives. There will be planting of native species later in the spring. Another piece of this involves the beaver management plan, which Vicki Hennessy has developed a very detailed plan that includes a lot of information about the natural history of the beavers and wetlands. And part of it is a draft of what is being called Beaver Management Task Force. And this task force would be doing things around anything involving the beavers. So for example, there is the need to put in another flow device in a dam that the beavers have made. And the grant will cover these kind of things, possibly putting fencing around trees that we don't want beavers to take out, fencing around trees that get planted so that they can grow big enough. And Pat, I think Vicki has talked with Patty about, well, how should this task force function? And at present, the plan is to have some neighbor stakeholders involved in this group, as well as people who are naturalists and people who want to get in and actually do some work. And so Patty had thought, since this is on village property, maybe it should be a separate commission. Then I suggested that, given that this is all a trial at this point, that it how about if it serves as sort of a pilot task force for a year, see how it goes, and then at the end of the first year, come back with a recommendation of, well, you know, this worked, this didn't work, but come back with a recommendation on how to continue whatever it needs to be continued.
How are they going to interact with village staff? And I guess I can see the potential for if there's disagreement in strategy.
So any major, well, really any activity has to go through staff.
Okay. Right. Jason is going to be a member of the task force, okay. and on any of the larger, bigger decisions that are, should we cut this down or whatever, then I will get involved. And then if it's anything huge, obviously it would come to council.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
So another thing that will be done is to develop some information about the baseline, which is what's there now, what does it look like now, there is an Antioch professor who I'm not sure whether he's going to get his students in there, but ideally we would really get to know what are the species that are in there now so that as things change we can see what changes are happening. Also, I'm going to see whether we can get some donations for a small endowment that would cover whatever minor expenses would need to be ongoingly. And we're not expecting that once we get the paths established and some signage that there really won't be a lot of ongoing work or expenses. So at this point, I want to ask Council, how would you like me to report out about this? Is there other information you want?
Written. I mean, this is a lot of information to just be taking in on the spot. So does Environmental Commission not do minutes?
Yeah. I don't think we want to have the Environmental Commission minutes, but.
Well, something. I mean, this, I was actually going to ask this when you were done, that this is an awful lot of information to take in, that it would have been nice to have that in the packet.
It would have been, and I didn't do that. My bad.
So just, the only reason I'm saying minutes is that all of that could have been potentially in the minutes. I don't know.
Well, see, a lot of this is happening outside the Environmental Commission. We're meeting with the Council Land Trust, Tom, Dietrich, and I, and Vicki.
That's your summation of the things you thought you needed to know.
So I'm happy to write up what I have written up. Would you like that at the next council meeting?
Sure, yeah.
Okay.
I mean, it's not just for us. I think it's just to have something on the record for the community to be able to read to.
I'll do that.
I have one question. Are you done?
Mm-hmm.
Well, sounds like, I mean, you're doing so much, it's crazy. That's a lot, what you're doing, which is wonderful. But I have a question. When you take out invasive species, how do you keep them out?
Then put a herbicide on the stump.
I know,
like they're doing at the
I know, you, but you how put. Do you keep, but so okay, so you put in, then you replant the native species that had gotten pushed out by the invasive. Is this an ongoing task, or is there actually stabilize? This is something I've been wondering about for a long time.
Well,
so now that you're doing all that, I was curious.
Much of what is going to be taken out, which is the Bradford pear, is going to be turned into prairie. So
once it becomes prairie
will need to be mowed, like once a year, I guess.
Mowed, not burned?
Mowed,
no burning,
I think probably what the...
Yeah, neighbors would probably appreciate that.
Okay. And that's how you keep it prairie and not turning back to other things.
Yes, that's my understanding. This is not my area of expertise, but I will say we had several people from the Beaver Creek Wetlands, from the Dayton Parks.
Good.
We had a number of people come out and walk around.
Good.
Okay, so I will write up a written report for the next meeting, and then I have HRC report. HRC had a retreat, which I thought was very good, and mostly we focused on how we work together as a commission. And during that time, we realized that we're probably going to be losing two members, two, maybe three, and so we are going to be looking for some more members, and we all already, I think, have some people that had several, maybe even a year ago, submitted letters of interest. So we would want to reach out first to those people. But we came up with some things that are in the charge that I think we need to look at more thoroughly, and we can talk about them, I think, at our retreat when we talk about commissions. So I'm done.
Thanks. And it really was good. No, it was great, great work. It just is overwhelming.
I know. I apologize. I should have done it, but I was doing other things.
No wonder. You were busy, girl.
Record it. Give us a do little recorded things or something.
Recorded?
You can. Oh, you can. Make blogs or something.
You can dictate it into your phone.
The chamber. Our next meeting is April 21st. It's a member benefits meeting, so it's always a great meeting to come to if you are a new member or if you're considering joining the chamber, because there are a lot of financial benefits and other benefits to being members. Last week, we actually had somebody from Mike DeWine's office come to talk about civil rights and accessibility. That was a really good one. And Marianne mentioned Earth Day, and the chamber is again doing the Shred It in conjunction with Greenfest with the Glen's Earth Day celebration. We will be doing it on April 23rd from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. So that's the big Shred It truck coming in that will shred all of your documents. Very secure. You can stand and watch it all being shredded. It will be in the parking lot that's next to the Children's Center at the corner of Corey and Limestone. So, and we're looking into bringing in other kinds of recycling like they did last year. I may want to talk to you guys about that.
Yeah.
Okay, and probably the Resilience Network. So,
yeah.
Because I'm definitely interested. People
George
really appreciated
is our
it.
Recycling guy.
Okay, I will talk to you guys about that.
Was
then.
Batteries part of that last year?
It was. I mean, there were a lot of things, and I'm not going to promise anything at this point because most of those places they actually charge you. I mean, we would have to pay a couple hundred bucks to get the batteries. Although we're paying a lot of money to get the Shred It truck in here too, but to just keep piling all that on top would be a little bit of a challenge. So. Maybe we can find some other alternatives. So MVRPC, it was the quickest meeting ever because we just elected the officers and the executive committee. So that didn't take long, and that was it. So, okay, future agenda items. The ordinance regarding the electric rate structure, is that what, are we going to have some discussion or?
I think you had decided, I had sort of spoken with folks individually and asked how much information had you wanted prior to the ordinance coming to the table, and folks seemed to indicate that they were fine with that information accompanying the ordinance at the time. So
okay.
I think you're clear for that.
Okay. And one of the things that we have on our goals is to meet with SpringsNet. They requested a work session. One of the things we have in our goals is to schedule a work session with them. And I think we may have decided at the last meeting that that we really needed to come up with a list or an idea of what this work session would accomplish. It feels a little early for a work session. So what we were hoping to talk about at the next meeting is for council to bring their questions, concerns about for SpringsNet about the wireless, the fiber project, and we would then discuss that, and that would basically form the basis for the work session. Does that sound reasonable?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and Judy, can we put the white paper back in the packet? Just because that would probably be good for everybody to
mm-hmm.
review.
Yep.
So it looks like we've got the Arts and Culture Commission annual report, Planning Commission annual report. And I'm assuming, are these all planning?
Yes.
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 So we've got lots of ordinances.
Mm-hmm. I think Denise's fingertips are really sore from
yeah, but and they're I'll, not. But it should go pretty
They're all
pretty
sequential
yeah.
kinds of things.
Yeah, mm-hmm. right. This language changing, I think it was. But
okay.
It shouldn't take as long.
So I think
so we'll bring back
something
yeah.
for.
Yep. Hopefully that will lead to legislation. on the task force?
You know, I'm thinking it might be a good idea to move the Arts and Culture Commission report to the 18th.
Okay.
Because at the last meeting, there were some members missing, so I'm not really sure they're ready. Nothing was approved. And then can we add the Tecumseh Land Trust request?
And I think what a couple of council members have asked the clerk is to get more information. I think from Krista on the request, and maybe something a little bit more specific about how this event would fit into the goals.
Village values, yeah. And then we talked about the rules and procedures for the station.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Did you, if I'm remembering this right, did you want a resolution regarding the Glen purchase, or are you still awaiting?
No, I'm sorry, Patty, we'll have more information on that, so we'll have, hopefully, the Sutton Farm.
So that's just an update, because she still needs to gather the...
You don't know, you're not expecting it for the next meeting?
Well, the next thing that I believe we have to do, Chris, is we have to pass the ordinance saying we'll provide services, and correct?
No, you're selling it. If we're selling it...
You said the Glen annexation.
Well, I don't know if I spoke the word annexation. Anyway.
If I can get an appraisal, yes.
So we'll just put it on there tentatively. Next steps, Sutton Farm.
Next steps. And then will you have something regarding the annexation? Is there...
That's all... Oh, there is...
There were other steps, but we're not ready to come back to council yet.
Okay.
We've got to deal with the township and the county commissioners.
Do we need, does anybody from council or staff need to be supporting going to any of these meetings to express our support?
Is it expedited?
It is expedited. I'll have a timeline later this week that I'm sharing with Patty. And then Judy is an integral part of this as well.
Okay.
You may not know that, but...
I do recall from that past annexation, yeah.
I need to coordinate with Judy and Patty.
Something,
right.
Well, something I've discovered, though, is that the county commissioners, if anything is coming before them that has to do with our community, they're expecting representation there. No matter how easy a decision it is, they want somebody there.
That's correct, but that's part of the reason why Patty has been designated as the agent.
Okay, good. So April 18th, I mean, it looks, we've got, I'm assuming we may have some of the things moving forward to April 18th if we don't get them done on the 4th. And we obviously have second readings on all of these ordinances, so.
And I will not be at that meeting.
Okay, ooh, that's going to be interesting. So that, I will say that probably puts the Sutton Farm situation in a little bit of a pickle.
No, because Melissa's...
Melissa can hand?
Yeah.
Okay, so she could bring that appraisal? Okay.
Yes, if I don't have it at the next meeting, yeah, she can bring it.
I have a question about the net metering ordinance.
The Energy Board is going to start where... Actually, I was in communication with Rick Walkie and suggested to him that Johnny and I start on it internally, work out some real basic framework, and then take it to the Energy Board so that the Energy Board could help refine it to bring it to council.
So you anticipate being ready by the 18th?
No. I think that's on there because Karen would like a placeholder for it so we don't forget.
Oh, okay.
But no.
No, well, I know if it, then we can either, let's just take it off. I mean, you guys are remembering it.
It's going to be a few months.
Okay.
At least.
Okay. So. And you all remember what we're doing on Thursday? Is it this Thursday?
Yes, it is.
This Thursday is our retreat, so we'll be spending the day together.
And please don't forget the arrangements for Melissa's father.
Yes, that's a Wednesday. What is, there's arrangements for a group of us to go. The funeral is in Xenia. And that's on Wednesday.
It is, and I emailed the arrangements to all of you yesterday. So if you didn't get them, please let me know, or I texted them or something.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Thank you all for a good meeting, good discussion. Entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Should get that to Judy.